Raditz was flying in mid-air, following a rather strange but also quite fascinating young woman. They were heading over to his brother Kakarot's place, out around the plains of Mount Paozu. Naturally, despite their ability to fly, it was going to take them a while. Now, normally, Raditz just wouldn't accept the blind instruction of a complete and total stranger whom he had absolutely no idea of who she was, and yet, he was okay with it. He had this strange feeling of recognition, ease, that he couldn't quite place or explain. It just felt right. Her energy felt right as well, almost as if it would naturally feel like family to him. I mean, there were so many questions that Raditz had for this one, as they made their way to Kakarot's home. So, to pass the time and to feel like he wasn't being too much of a silly billy, Raditz chose to air one of those in the here and now. How come young Buller thought that you were on the level? What did you say to her before you saw me? The woman turned to Raditz and shrugged.
We just clicked is all. Besides, she's your daughter. Surely her being a good judge of character runs in the family, right? Why would you even question it?
Raditz was about to curse her out for some backchat and sass, but actually, he ended up just cursing under his breath. Dang it, this one was good. She knew how to push his buttons, but he rolled with it anyway. It was a good enough answer.
I mean, of course, my daughter's just like her old man. I guess you can't be all that bad if she thinks that you're okay, but there's something that still doesn't sit right with me. Why do you need me and Kakarot? What could be so important that a simple phone call wouldn't have sufficed?
The teal-haired femme's tone switched from playful to stern.
I think you know where this playbook is heading towards, dude. You know, it's like one of those sci-fi movies. Surely you'd be able to pick up what I'm doing.
Raditz thought for a second.
Wait, I think I know. Maybe the one with the robot from the future that is after that gal and there's a motorcycle involved? I mean, not the future, because the future time travel, that's completely ridiculous.
Kinda.
Oh, right. Well, I can see why this may need both our persons then, if it's that serious.
With that, the pair of them were just on the brink of the Paozu region, ready to head towards Kakarot and Chi-Chi's home.
That is until Kakarot showed up, prematurely.
He had actually sensed the two powers coming his way for a good long while now. He was debating with Chi-Chi as to what to do with this. One of them was Raditz and one he sort of didn't recognize but sort of did. And instead of possibly endangering Chi-Chi or Kyaro, or maybe thinking it's just Raditz wanting to train so you just meet him halfway, he went to go and talk to the powers ahead of their landing. He then, however, immediately relaxed when he saw his brother completely casual, not under duress, and present with a similarly well-built lady. Never seen this one before, yet she looked so similar to somebody.
That hair color, that was Bulma? When did you start training?
Raditz, since when could she bench weights and suddenly dress like some kind of biker? He said this out of complete bewilderment. The dame looked a little anxious, but before she could think of a response that could suit Kakarot's furrowed brow,
Kakarot, show some manners! This lady here needs our help! She asked very nicely, and my daughter Bulla thought she was all right, so why don't we just hear her out, all right? We were able to take down Frieza, so if she kicks off, we can kick her ass, right?
Kakarot pondered for a moment, before firing a ki blast at the woman's direction, completely catching Raditz off guard, but she deflected this rather easily. Raditz was horrified at his brother's lack of etiquette and tact, or diplomacy, but the woman wasn't flustered at all. The pair looked at each other, before Kakarot smiled, relieved at the lack of hostility.
Alright, you're good. Thanks for your patience, pal. Come on, let's go. Chi-Chi's got some food going, by the way.
Raditz's mood was immediately elevated at the sound of food, going from complete horror and fear to excitement at some lunch. And the woman was equally interested. It's almost like she was part Saiyan. After introductions, the group of Raditz, Chi-Chi, Kakarot, Kyaro, and the lady were busy discussing her presence over lunch. Now, in her mind, this wasn't the ideal setting for her potential announcement, but the green-haired girl felt that this was honestly the best option she had, and also, she was kinda hungry. And after all, she knew that Saiyans wouldn't commence battles during a meal, or fly off the handle. I mean, think of the waste of food. Flipping tables, throwing food all over the place. I mean, it would be a complete disaster. It's a Saiyan's worst nightmare. She began to explain her situation, feeling that this group of people were trustworthy, that they wouldn't blab or over-exaggerate or get aggravated at what she had to say. Listen, this is going to be a little heavy for you all to take in. You see, I'm not from around here. So, like, East City? I mean, we don't often get those kinds of folks around here anymore. Not since the Westmen caused that upset in the Battle Ball Finals last year. No, a lot further away than that. I come from the future. Everyone dropped their cup thrilling in amazement at that bit of news. Everyone was silent for a good long while. But then, Raditz thumped his fist on the table, getting a very stern look from the hostess.
Of course! The plane of travel that you spoke of was to do with dimensions! Oh, and the movie reference, I understand it now! Oh, time travel, yes!
Raditz looked utterly pleased with himself for figuring all of this out himself, to the stunned silence from the rest of the room. How did he figure that out? On his own?
What? You don't spend all your days with a genius wife and not take in some of what she has to say? A jargon? A psychobabble? I do listen, you know!
The future lady laughed. I knew you would get it eventually, Raditz. Another thing I need to tell you all is that my name, it's Bando.
Now, folks, you probably guessed already who she is without me needing to tell you, but this is a pseudonym based on Obando Top, which could also be considered a type of garment that would be fitting for the name reference to Bulla, her base name.
But I'm not here for some kind of vacation. I came to tell you folks a very important message. I didn't want to make a big scene or anything or get everyone involved, and I also know that you can keep this quiet. I trust you. Or at least, not tell the full story to the rest of the crew. In about 3 years' time, two androids of unspeakable power emerged from the shadows and completely decimated the entire population of Earth. The world within days was taken under their control. All for the sake of entertainment, fun, sport, their own amusement, ordered by those that you had utterly wasted, Raditz. Or you thought you had. The Red Ribbon Army.
Raditz once again thumped the table.
Raditz, either quit doing that or get out of my house!
Shouted Chi-Chi as she jumped up in protest.
Sorry, it's just that I thought I'd completely wiped out those scoundrels years ago. How could I possibly miss some of them? I thought I was extremely thorough.
It's not your fault. They had other bases that you weren't aware of, but they are formidable, and they will stop at nothing to tear into every single one of you. You thought that your attack, Raditz, on their base was brutal? Wait until you see what they did in my timeline, what they would do in yours, in retaliation. But with me being here, she pressed her hand on her chest with a hint of smugness and relief that Raditz felt very relatable with. I might have prevented it. Kiara then piped up.
Ma'am, doesn't you coming back in time kind of cause a paradox or something? A complete destruction of certain events? Isn't it dangerous you being here?
Bando gulped.
We don't know the full truth of that yet, kiddo. Truth be told, this is the first time I've ever piloted the thing that got me here. I guess we'll just see what happens when I get home.
She did not assure the crowd present at her uncertainty.
I've said way more than I really should have, but I simply cannot let another timeline go through what my one has. All I can tell you to do is to train like you've never trained before. And for you, Chi-Chi, to be extra careful. Same goes for Bulma, Raditz.
Both of the Saiyans were concerned and immediately nodded that they would protect their bells.
In all safety, it might be best for them to train up too, or at least keep somewhere safe for the duration. I wouldn't say these things lightly. In my future, I was quite fond of them.
Was?
Well, you heard the lady, boys. I should get my training gear out and catch up.
Kakarot was stunned, but also excited to see his partner maybe getting back into training again. It had been quite a few years since she'd actually taken this seriously. He was kind of thrilled.
But I don't understand. This simply doesn't add up. How can we not protect them? We're Saiyans, extremely strong Saiyans. Surely we would be able to fend off whatever came their way.
Bando shook her head, with a tinge of sadness in her voice.
Neither of you make it to the battle. 6 months beforehand, you each die from a suspected heart condition.
Kakarot now slammed his fist on the table.
Damn it! We don't even have a chance to defend our home? Oh what? Kakarot gets to slam the table and I don't!
Kakarot looked up grimly.
I made this table. It'll hold.
Banda read the room and immediately tried to lighten the spirit of it.
It'll be alright though. We found a cure for it in the future eventually.
She took off her bandana, her long hair flowing elegantly as she rummaged for it in said bandana, pulling out two vials of medicine.
If you take these about 6 months before May 12th, 3 years from now, and with gradually increased doses for the next few weeks after that, you should be able to stave off the worst of the effects of the condition and be able to continue to fight. With your additional force, this should be a piece of cake.
The brothers looked at the bottles and now considered these two things to be the most important possessions that they had. They vowed to take the medicine, to which Bando was most grateful.
Sweet. Well, that's all I gotta do here. I'm glad that you took this so well, guys. Be sure to tell the rest of the crew and get them to train up as well. With each person still alive and kicking, these androids won't know what hit them.
She clenched her fist with sincerity, as if she were pleading with them to please get this right, to follow through on her instructions and words.
Just one more thing, Bando.
Yeah?
She turned to Raditz.
If you have a time machine, could you show Bomerit before you go? She's always wanted to know if time travel were possible, and now that I know it's true, I can show her and she'd be so happy.
She's got more important matters to deal with, Raditz. I don't want to distract her. Also, I'm kind of busy. All out of time and all. You time travel, out of time, get it?
She looked overly jovial at that phrase, but nevertheless, she was serious. She didn't have the time. But she did promise to show them the machine as she left for her timeline. When they walked outside, she waved them goodbye, pulled out a capsule, and reminded them all about their mission. They watched the capsule corp machine take off, and within seconds, it disappeared from view. As Bando, real name Future Buller, was heading back to her present, she sighed and let out a sob.
She'd done it. The time machine had worked. She had possibly saved Chi-Chi and Bulma from a terrible fate. A heinous rebirth under Dr. Giraud's malice.
She didn't want to show Bulma the time machine because she knew that if she clocked eyes on her mother from the past, she would have broken down, ruined the mission after all the things that she'd seen in her future. Yeah, it just wasn't possible. With that, she was away.
Raditz and Kakarot were left slack-jawed, boogie-eyed, but determined. They were going to train the most they had done in all their years of being on Earth. All those other villains and enemies that they had dealt with, that was just chump change. They were keen to finish the business that was the Red Ribbon Army. Kakarot especially, since he knew how much it meant to Raditz that they were gone. And yes, it had been proven that he had not done that good of a job, Raditz, in making sure that they were gone. So, Raditz, I mean, he was the most angry of them all. This Dr. Giraud Bando had spoken of was the real brains of the operation, not Commander Red. And thusly, he had to be stopped. Now, this is where you might think he would do what Goku and Vegeta wanted to do in the original show, and maybe wait for the future to take care of things and seek a challenge, but not this, Raditz. If you've been around this channel for a while, you know that's not how any Raditz would operate. Remember, Raditz was born a schemer, a sneak, and if there is a golden opportunity to right a wrong or head something off at the pass, he will take it.
Brother, I know this is not exactly the way we Saiyans usually do things, but I feel that this solution is different. You saw how Bando looked. How about we take care of this now? Sort this out for her before it even becomes a problem.
Kakarot was confused.
What do you mean?
Do I need to repeat myself? I get a feeling Bulma might know who this Giraud is. Doctors, scientists, surely she would know. I mean, the name does ring a bell. She surely mentioned it before.
Kakarot wasn't sure where Raditz was going with this, but he chose to roll with it. After all, the Red Ribbon and Raditz, they were sort of connected. At Capture Corp, Bulma indeed did know who this person was. Dr. Giraud, former worker of the Red Ribbon Army, chief scientist, shunned by the higher-ups in his old age, took refuge in the caves and mountains outside North City.
Raditz, you plan on taking this guy out now? Or what about the idea of vigilante justice? He hasn't done anything yet. Haven't those sci-fi movies I've shown you taught you nothing?
Bulma, think about it. Dr. Giraud was one of the major scientists of the organization when we did fight him. He already had committed copious atrocities before now. This is merely retribution for all of that and preventative medicine for us. Kakarot, let's do this.
Got it, bro. Are we still gonna train a whole lot afterward? Like, I was kinda looking forward to that and pleasing that Bondo lady.
You bet! I'm all fired up!
Bondo? Who's that? Bulma said.
Oh, the future girl we met. I meant to say her name before. She kinda looks like, you, bizarrely.
Oh. She does? Bondo. Wait. Were her eyes the same color as, but before she could get a reply, both Kakarot and Raditz were gone. Off to North City. And that's where we're going to be leaving things for right now.